There we go. Oh, you know what it was? I renamed all my slides so that they would stay in order. Simple problem. Did not know I had it until I tried it. Nothing wrong here. I'm not gonna complain about anything in particular in the White Tower. A lot of this stuff, like I said, is stuff that I want to talk to Chad about because he's got really good insight about how the show feels. I'm biased, and it causes problems for objectivity. Like, when he watched it, it was the very first time he had ever seen the show and had ever heard of the Wheel of Time. And from what he said, it's, like, kind of overwhelming, like Game of Thrones. If you never read the books, super overwhelming with all the things and moving parts going on. Nothing to say about this. Let me see where I'm going at. Okay, so again, I don't necessarily have a problem with any of this. Ishamael is walking through like a valley, and it's specifically says on the Amazon X-ray that he's in Kyrian. It doesn't really say where, but he is in a physical place and he sees a seal. I guess he knows where these seals are at, and these are supposed to be seals. We don't really know. I think Moraine does say in the show that there's seals on the Dark One's prison, but I don't really know how to verify that. This is not what the seals are in the books, and it doesn't really matter. I think it's probably going to cause a problem later on because the actual seals are like hand-sized, like they're little discs, and they're made out of Quaendar, and them being fragile and breaking is a big plot point in the books. Like, you find it out really soon, so it's not like a spoiler or anything. But like having these big gigantic seals kind of, it makes me wonder how we're going to address it at the end of the series. And that's something that, again, I want to talk to Chad about. I'm just trying to get my thoughts in order before we stream, probably tomorrow. Okay, so here we have Ishamael channeling. I like this. It's got like a little, almost like brass knuckles on his left hand. Nothing to say there. Visually, it's stunning. I love everything about how their channeling looks. I don't necessarily like how it works, but I do like how it looks. It looks pretty. And I actually saw a short or a TikTok, I think that Chad sent me, that shows like the difference between channelers that the show writers and the graphics team spent a lot of time on. It actually explains a lot of the motion from Moraine, like how she moves her whole body. She's in a very fluid and controlled motion, and like Nynaeve's big bursts of power. And then I think the real example was like Leandrin is very wound up tight, and so all her weaving looks very, very tight in every time it's on screen. So interesting. I don't really get anything from Ishamael channeling other than that there seems to be several threads. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's a lot. 6 is a lot. And then he releases this person. She's covered in blood. And he's reciting a verse from a dark prophecy that we hear later. And I do have the sections cut out of the book. I don't know where they're at in my list, but I'll get to them. Oh, here they are. Look at me go. So in the books, this is a prophecy of the dark. Not sure exactly what the title or word is for it. But I'm going to go ahead and read it and then kind of talk through it a little bit. This is one of the things that I didn't want to waste Chad's time on, because this is book background. And while he is interested in it, it does tend to make the streams really long. So, Daughter of the Night, She Walks Again. That's going to be referring to Lanfear. The Ancient War She Yet Fights. That's the Forsaken against Luz Theron and all the forces of good. Her new lover she seeks. She's looking for the reincarnation of the dragon, who shall serve her and die. That is a very specific prophecy. And it's debatable whether that comes true or not. I'm going to have to think about that some more. Who shall serve her and die, yet still serve. I think that's maybe true. I'm going to have to think about that some more. Who shall stand against her coming? The shining walls shall kneel. I actually don't remember what the shining walls are. There's probably somebody that knows. And then in the audiobooks, this always feels really cool. It's the version I have is read by Kate Redding, and she does a really good job. Blood feeds blood, blood calls blood, blood is, and blood was, and blood shall ever be. And then we go to the next verse. The man who channels stands alone. So if it's a prophecy, it's immediately false, because there's lots of men that channel and they don't stand alone. That's like a big plot point of the books. It may be talking about a specific man, but I don't know exactly who that could be. He gives his friends for sacrifice. Two roads before him, one to death beyond dying, one to life eternal. I really should have read this before I started. Because now I'm getting into like spoiler territory. Which shall he choose? Which shall he choose? What hand shelters? What hand slays? Blood feeds blood. Blood calls blood. Blood is, and blood was, and blood shall ever be. Luke came to the mountains of doom. I saw him, waited in the high passes. Those come true. We haven't met them yet, but it's good. The hunt is now begun. The shadows' hounds now course and kill. One did live and one did die, but both are. The time of change has come. I'm starting to think that this prophecy was a fresh prophecy, because a lot of these are relevant to the Great Hunt where this passage comes from. And if the prophecy was written and discovered right at that timeline, all of this does make sense and does come true. So I'm curious. I'm going to have to go back. I don't usually pay attention a lot to the prophecies anymore. They're not terribly interesting to me. I do want to look into that one some more. My music vanished. Or I'm just in a different song. And then here's the last verse. Blood feeds blood. Blood calls blood. Blood is, and blood was, and blood shall ever be. The watchers wait on Toman's head. That's true. The seed of the hammer burns the ancient tree. Also true. Death shall sow and summer burn before the great Lord comes. This is important. Spoiler alert. If you hear anybody refer to the Dark One as the Great Lord, they are not a good person. Anyways, death shall sow and summer burn before the great Lord comes. Death shall reap and bodies fail before the great Lord comes. Again, the seed slays ancient wrong before the great Lord comes. Now the great Lord comes. Now the great Lord comes. And then we repeat a little bit. Repeat a little bit of the earlier parts. I really want to dig into some of these. Because we get several prophecies. We get like the prophecy of the dragon. We get this one. We get the Aiel prophecy. We get Shan Chan prophecy. We get Sharon prophecy. Like we get prophecies from just about everywhere. And they're interesting to dig into. I do want to talk to Chad about Lan's chapters or sections, but I really don't have anything to say. There's not really anything like I could be as negative as I want. The only thing I really wanted to talk about is Alana does mention Cad Swain again, so I'm calling her right now. Cad Swain is showing up soon. I think maybe as early as season 3, especially if they're escalating timelines. She needs to be there. It makes sense, and that's my hot take, and I'm sticking to it. Got some meditation going on. I organize these by who the main person is, and then put them in chronological order of the show. And so this is like towards the end of the episode. Alana finds the copy of the Dark Prophecy. And then, okay, so we got Matt. This is something that I'm going to end up having a problem with. Min has a dream, and in the dream, her family is forcing her to basically read the auras of people, which, you know, okay, that it's plausible. It's not what happened in the books at all, but it is kind of, does kind of make like a kind of twisted sense. This isn't how it played out in the books, so, you know, who's to say if this works or not? I'm interested in this foretelling, or whatever you want to call it, this viewing. This like design on the face here feels specific, and I can't remember where it's from. I want to say something off the wall like Sharon, but I would need to see their back to see if the tattoo is back there. I could be totally wrong. I don't know who else would have like these miscolorings on their face. Maybe they get poisoned or burned or something. I don't know. I'll have to keep an eye out for it. Anytime Min does a viewing, I'm interested in it because I want to see if the show keeps track of it. So at this point in the episode, we have already discovered that Lanfear and I think Lanfear's last. I think it's Leandrin and then Ishamael and then Lanfear. So in this episode, we find out that Black Aja is strong and in the heart of the tower, basically. And then we find out that this guy is not the Dark One. He's Forsaken, which we kind of already knew because Moraine said it a couple times. And then we find out about Lanfear at the end. This is where Ishamael is forcing Min and Matt to Kyrian. Again, don't really agree with the choice, but Matt is supposed to go to Kyrian, so that's fine. This is Moraine's younger sister. This is like one of those things where we're meshing a lot of things from the books into the show. to not tie it all together, just to kind of demonstrate that they at least are thinking about it. That she pulls some Game of Houses bullshit on Moraine, basically telling her that she has to have tea with her, or she can't find out where Rand is. Moraine barges in and like takes over the house. I'm just gonna skip ahead. These are all Moraine's slides. She's looking at her memories here. None of this is stuff I want to talk about by myself. This little jewel on her forehead, I've been looking for that since episode one. She's supposed to have it, like, all the time. Not really sure. Who knows? This could be the butterfly effect that sent everything in motion. Maybe that's why she got hit with a spear or something. I'm gonna turn my mic down just a little bit to see what happens. It's still turning red, but I'm not really sure why it's doing that. Test, test. Okay. Can't do anything about it. She goes and talks to Loghain. Again, I don't really think Moraine talks to Loghain in the books at all. Doesn't really matter. I was looking for something specific here. But this, she does make a good point. Being cut off from the One Power is brutal, and a knife would be an easy escape compared to what he has to deal with otherwise. She's looking for Rand. This is where she tries to talk to her. We find out later that these are like her eyes and ears, her spies that she keeps track of. And her sister has taken them over. Yeah, right here. It's kind of her villain moment. Okay, these are Nynaeve slides. We see the White Tower. It looks super beautiful. Good. I love the set work on the show. And I will be talking about that with Chad some more. Nynaeve is sad. Egwene really shows a lot of compassion. Egwene had some really good things on screen that I'll talk about some more later. I don't think I caught Nynaeve in her accepted. Where it's got the multicolors on her sleeves. I have really good shots of those somewhere. Leandrin gets a note. Based on something I'm going to ask Chad tomorrow, is the note that Leandrin got, is how did she get it so fast and who did she get it from? I don't know. I mean, I know, but I don't know. Anyways, Leandrin comes in here and has a tussle with the Keeper. Not a good idea. And then she issues a parting shot, basically threatening her. I don't know if this is true. I'm going to move on. Leandrin's setting the hook here. Like, go to Falm. They're calling it Falm. I think it's Falma, but doesn't matter. And I think this is where I'm going to get into like kind of the nitty gritty, because I'm a little upset with, not really upset, I want to talk about some differences. Without Chad here, I'm going to get really upset if I let myself. But here we have Perrin and Elias. And so here Elias is talking about, I'm the pack, basically. It's not really how it works, but that's how he's explaining it. And then this is a great spot that they put into the show. So they've got Perrin. I think he spent like, I don't know, most of the series worried about like turning into a wolf. There's so many unanswered questions about being a wolf brother that this is kind of nice to just have answered right away. It kind of confirms my theory of compressing the show down into less than 14 seasons. He's worried about changing into a wolf, specifically in book two, and with no resolution. I don't think he talks to Elias about it for a really, really long time, and they never give him a straight answer. He finds out on his own. It's not really pack mentality. They don't really have scouts. It's kind of like one of the issues I had. Like, when he says the line, he makes it sound like this is an army of wolves. It's not an army, it's just a pack. They just do their own thing. You know, they're not going to say, you know, Scout Hopper reporting for duty has spotted a buck or whatever. It's just going to be like an impression of, like, the hunt is on. You know, it's fine. I know they have to put dialogue in the show, but this is tough. This was tough to watch as a whole. I really thought I had a shot of the buck. I guess I missed it. We get a visual of how the communication works anyway. Elias is setting the stage for future when Perrin starts to crave his meat a little less well done later on in the series. So that's fine. Also, I learned some trivia. A lot of times when they have these like steaks or raw meat or whatever, a lot of time it's like painted watermelon, which I thought was cool. This is interesting. This isn't true, but it's plausible. It might be true. I know it's plausible for sure. Perrin subconsciously sending out his thoughts. Like, his thoughts are easy to read by the wolves and presumably by Elias. And it's plausible enough that I can't remember that specific detail from the book, but I believe it. So I don't think he says anything to that effect. I'll have to go back and check. And then my big, like, it's actually like a point in one of our episodes that Chad and I did together, was that Chad was convinced that Elias had met Perrin already before season two. And I was telling him, no, that's from the book and it's missing in season one. And this kind of explains why. I don't know if this was already planned by the show writers, but he's technically right. They don't like going near women that can channel, and technically they don't like going near anybody that's people. Wolves don't typically want to be around people. So this explains why they didn't show up when like Perrin and Egwene were being pushed towards the caravan, the Tinker caravan. But then he goes on to say that he's the one that saved them from the White Cloaks, which makes sense. Here, I'm going to talk to Chad about this as well, because I think we already talked about it on the phone. These visuals are fantastic. I've been scratching my head when they announced the show of how to show the communication between the wolves. And again, visually, it's fantastic. You can't really get much better than this, I don't think. It's pretty awesome. Okay. We're gonna go back to Rand. And I really wish I knew. I'm just gonna pause for a second. I really wish I knew what OBS is doing when it's giving me these little red icons on the far left. I don't. I wonder. I wonder if it's... Is it this? Is that what it's doing? Turn it back up a little bit. It's got to be this. So I've got a decibel, like basically a decibel reader on here, and I can change. We'll see how this sounds. I'm kind of curious. I don't want to like tweak too much without some feedback, but I'll just, let me add a marker right here so I can go back and listen to that. Add stream marker. Okay, moving on. Just gonna skip through a bunch of this. Looks cool. I like the again, like the TikTok that I saw was pretty accurate. Now that I'm looking for it, Rand's kind of new to channeling, so his weaves are all over the place. Not a lot of continuity or tight straight lines or even tight arcs. They're kind of asymmetrically wavy, they're thin, they're thick, they're all over the place, basically. I like it. I like the visual. I don't know what her plan was here. This is something that I've been thinking about since I finished the episode. So what I think was going to happen was that Rand confessed to Lanfear that he's a channeler, and she made a big production of it specifically so that she could reveal that she was a Forsaken to Rand and like beg for his approval or something. I'm not really sure. Anyways, she gets stabbed through the heart, which I thought was a cool scene, but it wasn't really all that great. Specifically because, like, one of the big points in the show is that, or in the books, is that Lanfear and all the Forsaken are just people. They're just people. They've got lots of experience and not a lot else going on. So this should have killed her, and that should be the end of it. And then Moraine like slits her throat and all this other stuff. Rand's pissed and captures Moraine. And then Moraine says, How does she know what the Forsaken can do? Part of the book mystery was that part of the book was the mystery of what the Forsaken could do. They were scary because we didn't know anything about them. So I don't care that they changed it. I just want them to explain it somewhere. Kind of like what they did with Perrin not getting to meet Elias in season one like he was supposed to. They at least gave us an explanation in season two. That's what I want. I want an explanation. You changed it. Please justify it. And they changed a lot about this altogether. Moraine can't channel. That never happened. Stabbed and slit Lanfear's throat. That shouldn't have happened. Like, none of this was going on. So I just want them to try to like build and piece together a story that explains this part at least. Self-healing is not a thing. I will say that this is kind of a cool... I wonder if I can zoom in on this. I probably can. Sloppy. But it does work. So these are, so the Aes Sedai call it the One Power. That's what they use. Or they call it the True Source. But the, oh, this is probably a spoiler. Shit. I mean, they're introducing it, so that's their fault. This is the power of the Dark One. It's called the One True Power, I think is the actual phrase they use. And if you use it a lot, you end up getting these black flecks running across your eyes. And it's supposed to be permanent. Once you get them, they're not supposed to go away. But in the show, it looks like they're hiding them. Or she can hide them or whatever. Which, you know, it makes sense for the show. It's a good touch. And then, of course, she starts to heal immediately. That's really it. This was mostly just a test to see if I could stream, and I think I figured it out. I think what I figured out is that I can do like a, I can make a specific setting to where the bit rate, like the video quality going out, is not consistent, and it just varies based on my internet connection. Instead of trying to force like 3,000 kilobytes per second or whatever, It just varies between like 1500 and 3000, depending on what my internet's choosing to do at the moment, which honestly is nice. It's really nice, actually. Smooth as butter. No drop frames. Streaming for 45 minutes. No issues. That might be the solution. We'll have to try it on a very busy day. But overall, I'm happy with it. All my stats on my task manager and stuff look fantastic. Everything looks really healthy, including my, it says I have a GPU. I don't have a dedicated one, just like the integrated one. And anyways, it used to be if I tried to like move a window or whatever, it would like spike to 100% and then stay there, and now it'll spike up a little bit and then chill out right after. Let's see, I have okay, well, I got that all off my chest. I'm glad I did it now instead of later. I really hate dumping on the show when Chad's on stream with me. So I needed to get some of that out of my system. And I think Chad made a good point. I think if I'm able to stream like this and not have any technical issues besides the internet, then I should be able to play Baldur's Gate. I was playing Minecraft last night seamlessly, so Baldur's Gate should be on the table. I was able to bring stream avatars up. Like, everything about this computer is telling me that I should be able to play BG3. So I'm going to give it a shot on stream. And I think I'm going to play with Chad. So should be pretty fun. Good stream. Thank you. I missed you. It's very difficult to talk without you to bounce off of, just for the record. Also, my chat works, which I wasn't expecting. Thanks. All right. Well, good night, you and me and my phone, I guess. And we'll give the second half of Avatar a shot tomorrow, or Wheel of Time, or whatever floats our boat. I think this is good. All right. See you.